Bloomberg Quint. Fresh off the ThyssenKrupp deal, Tata Steel's CEO and Managing Director TV Narendran joins us on Bloomberg Quint. Mr. Narendran, thank you very much for joining us. And I'm sure you're a very relieved man now that the joint venture is in many ways finalized, though of course I know that the fruition of it will take almost a year or so. My first question, sir, to you is this. You acquired Corus at what was the peak of the last commodity cycle and at the peak of the world economic boom as well. You are in some ways, one might say, exiting in some ways the European business also at a time when steel prices are now on the upswing. Not maybe the peak, but upswing. A big cycle in between. What are the lessons that Tata Steel has learned from this acquisition and European foray?
Well, in 2007, when we acquired Corus, things were certainly looking good, as you said. I don't think anyone predicted what was going to happen in 2008. And if you recall, in the first 1 year, I think we made £1 billion of EBITDA. So it was a good deal, at least for the first year. But obviously, what happened in 2008 had a very significant impact on our performance since then. The European markets themselves took a long time to recover. It's probably close to where it was in terms of steel consumption in 2008. Just this year or last year. So I think a lot has happened in Europe over the last 10 years. We've done a lot in the last 10 years in Europe as well. When we acquired Corus, it was an 18 million ton facility. We pruned it, we've got rid of some of the assets which we struggled with, and we brought it down to 10 million tons. So there's a lot of learnings for Tata Steel in the last 10 years, but this is a cyclical business. I think how we deal with the down cycles, how we deal with the difficult times, in some sense, determine what happens to us in the long term. And I think there are a lot of learnings. The teams have put in a lot of great work over the last 10 years. We are happy to be where we are today because I think we've created a sustainable enterprise in Europe. While we have reduced our stake in the company from 100% to 50%, but we are 50% of a larger company, a stronger company, structurally stronger company, which is able to sustain itself. So I think that's an important development as far as we are concerned.
You know, Mr. Narendran, I don't think you'll answer my next question, but I'm going to ask it nonetheless. You know, in the period of time that you discussed, the 10 years that you acquired Corus and are now exiting in some ways, or at least becoming 50% of a larger company, as you call it, many learnings, many cyclical moves. Do you believe that in the next few years you will see an opportunity to exit European steel altogether?
I think step one is for us to complete this transaction, create this enterprise which we believe has a good balance sheet and good cash flows. If it is a self-sustaining business which is strong on its own, there's no reason for us to exit. But the challenges of the last 10 years was because it was a drain on capital for us. And in some sense, it distracted us from the opportunities in India because of the challenges that we faced in Europe. If we have a self-sustaining enterprise which can stand on its own, which is strong in its own way, it's the second largest steel company in Europe, and the pro forma indicates that it can take care of itself, there's no reason why we shouldn't stay invested.
Wasn't Corus also the second largest steel company in Europe, sir? Or was it the third or fourth when you acquired it? I'm not trying to score small points.
I think it was third.
Third, yeah. No, the only point I'm making is you've gone from 18 to 10. You've gone from 100% ownership to 50% ownership. Ever since you acquired this asset, you've only been reducing your exposure to it in one way or the other for a variety of external reasons. I understand that. And so I'm just curious, in the next 5 years, can we expect that because of the same reasons that you decided to reduce your exposure to Europe, the fact that you were losing focus on the domestic market, for those very same reasons, you might even consider fully getting out of Europe in the next 3 to 5 years. You have an acquisition here in India to deal with, Bhushan Steel. You have a big competitor in JSW Steel to deal with. You have a market that seems to be, you know, sort of back on the upswing. Bye-bye to Europe in the next 3 to 5 years?
I don't think so. See, let's put things in perspective. When we acquired Corus, Tata Steel in India was 4 million tons and Corus was 18 million tons. So in many ways, even though in India, while we had a very strong cash flow, it would have been difficult for a 4 million ton operation, irrespective of the EBITDA margins, to take care of an 18 million ton operation, which was not doing well. Today, we are in a very different situation. Even before this transaction, the Indian business has been bigger than the European business. We are 13 million in India and 10 million in Europe. So we are structurally a much stronger enterprise than we were back then. And now we've created a stronger entity in Europe, which can take care of its own needs. And India is growing. So if India doubles its volumes in the next few years, as we've announced or as we plan to, India again becomes a 25, 26 million ton facility, and with fairly strong cash flows and a good EBITDA margin, we are better equipped to deal with the cyclicality which is inherent to our business. And the European markets also have come back to where it was 8-10 years back. I think it was the last of the major markets to recover after the crisis. But things are much better in Europe. You look at the way Spain has recovered, for instance. Spain was a big consumer of steel pre-2008, and it's come back to fairly good levels. So I think industrial activity in Europe is picking up. It's not going to be a fast-growing market, but it's not going to be the market that we've seen over the last 10 years.
Let me put it this way, Mr. Narendran, and since we're discussing strategy, maybe I'll ask you a hypothetical question. If you were today confronted with the choice of, let's say, making a big purchase in Europe and focusing on the domestic market, what would your decision be? And let me put a caveat there. You can't have both.
Well, we are not... Well, so we have, if you look at it, even over the last 10 years, during the times that you described, we've grown in India from 4 million to 13 million. So it's not that we've not grown in India. Growing three times your size in 10 years is not too bad. I know others have grown faster, but we've not done too bad. So I don't think it's a question of one or the other. Obviously, India is a more profitable market. India is the market which is growing. Anyone would, if you have to choose between a growing market and a mature market, you would pick a growing market. You would pick a market you've been operating in for 100 years. You pick a market where you have the strongest equity. So that's natural. But it's not as if we have to make that choice today. I think our plans
allow us to grow
in India as much as we
would like to. But you do, right, sir? You do need to make that choice. Sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. You do need to make that choice because from what I can understand of all the joint venture details with ThyssenKrupp, your IPO is at least 6 years out. Correct me if I'm wrong, but it's at least 6 years out. And so, I'm just wondering, do you intend to stay invested for those 6 years? That, you know, don't you feel that your effort, time, management, bandwidth, capital, everything will be better focused in growing the India business, especially because, like you pointed out, JSW Steel has stolen a march over you on some parameters, at least in this marketplace, and in others is snapping at your heels.
Sure. So to me, firstly, just to put things in perspective, the IPO choice or the when to trigger the IPO lies with Thyssen.
Correct.
So they can take that call. And it's not that we've said we will not do an IPO for 6 years. What we've said is for the first 6 years, we will have between us together, we will have more than 50% of the share. So it doesn't stop us from doing an IPO if we want to. That is one. Second point is if Europe doesn't require any capital from India, then to that extent they are self-sufficient, and it doesn't take away anything that India has. It's not that you're taking away money from India to invest in Europe and missing opportunities in India. So that's the second point.
Okay.
The third point is from a management point of view, we will now manage Europe as a JV. So far we've been managing it as a 100% subsidiary. So it'll be jointly managed by Thyssen and us. And we have a stronger enterprise there. Of course, all enterprises will need some managing, but I think we'll have a strong team there, and we'll have strong oversight from both Thyssen and us. So I think we are comfortable with what we planned ahead.
Okay, I'll stop bugging you with more Europe versus India questions and ask you a few operational questions about the joint venture. There was one bit I didn't quite understand. Maybe I'm coming to this conversation a little late. But I understand that Tata Steel Europe is contributing about 2.5 billion euros of debt to the joint venture. ThyssenKrupp is contributing about 4 billion. And yet, because of the divergence in financial performance of the two, ThyssenKrupp will effectively have economic interest of 55% when this company goes IPO. Till then, it will have 50 and you will have 50. What explains the difference in the amount of debt you all are both bringing to the table?
So firstly, the 2.5 billion euros of debt is being put in by Tata Steel into the JV, not Tata Steel Europe. It is lying
Tata
in the
Steel.
Parent
Sorry,
balance sheet.
Okay. Sorry. My
as far as Thyssen is concerned, they don't have any, as far as Thyssen is concerned, they don't have debt, but they have liabilities because of the pension funds, which is some 3.8 billion euros. So they put those liabilities into the JV. And that gets paid out at some 200 to 300 million a year. So that's what happens. So that's the liability that there is. It's not debt. So the JV will have a pro forma EBITDA of anything from 1.8 to 2.1, depending on how the synergies flow through, and debt of 2.5. It will have access to working capital lines about 1.5, and rest are liabilities which are paid out 200 to 300 million per year of million euros, which has paid out as far as the pension liabilities of the Thyssen enterprise is concerned. So that's the structure. So it's a fairly healthy balance sheet, which was the intent. The idea was to leave behind a company which is strong and can stand on its own. So that's the way it is structured. And as far as the ownership is concerned, what we've agreed is it's 50-50 in terms of the interest, economic interest, till such time we do an IPO. If we do an IPO, Thyssen gets another 10%. So at that time, in effect, it becomes 55-45. So the first 10% of the IPO will be sold by Thyssen,
correct,
which brings it to 45-45.
Yeah.
And if you have to sell any more, and if there is a minimum condition on how much we need to sell to do an IPO, then the partners will decide how much more each one wants to send and what will be the subsequent holding in the company.
Okay, I have just two more operational questions on the joint venture before I get to some India questions. One is, you seem to have marginally lowered the band of synergies,
sure,
versus the two, you know, the announcement from late last year, just by about 100 million euros, if I understand that correctly. Can you explain why? And can you also break up for us what the synergy accrual will be on an annual basis for the next few years?
So we had said 400 to 600, okay, that was more indicative. This is a bit more precise,
okay,
so it's more a bit of fine-tuning of the numbers. We do believe that as we go in, there will be opportunities for more. And these are annualized synergies. Obviously, it will kick in over the first couple of years. Some of them would be more immediate. For instance, the procurement synergies, which are maybe 30% of these synergies, could kick in the minute the JV company is formed, because it comes basically from being a bigger buyer of whatever you buy than you are today. Some of the synergies are to do with network optimization, which is to do with how do you physically optimize your distribution assets and everything else so that you don't have inefficiencies in the way you serve your customers, you don't have unnecessary costs which are incurred. So these are some of the synergies. Then there is an optimization of R&D expenses, for instance, because both companies may today be doing projects which are similar to each other, and so either you can use the same money to do more R&D projects or save some money doing the same projects, or rather not repeating the same projects.
Yeah.
So these are some of the synergies that have been identified, apart from some of the benefits which comes from reducing the workforce over a period of time, which also we had talked about. We've agreed with the unions that it will not be any forced redundancies. It will all be discussed. There is a consultation process in Europe, which we will go through and work on specific areas where we see optionalities.
Okay, you said 30% of synergies in form of procurement, 20% in terms of network optimization. That's about 50% of your synergies, which is 200 million to 250 million euros, will be available in the first year itself, right?
I would say in the first 12 to 24 months, because
okay,
some of these, absolutely.
Okay, last one on the JV, timeline of the JV, and we already hear of several of ThyssenKrupp's shareholders still not very happy with these revised terms of the joint venture. What kind of trouble are you expecting from them? Do you expect or anticipate any delays on account of the fact that some of their key shareholders, as well as some of the activist shareholders that have raised their voices earlier as well, are likely to, you know, sort of find fault with this revised terms of engagement as well?
So that's for Thyssen to deal with. I think they are engaged with their shareholders, and we'll leave it to them to have those conversations. For us, from a timeline point of view, what is important is the clearances from the European Commission. The Competition Commission there will take a call. So we will engage with them. We have already started engaging with them. They will take their time, so it depends on how comfortable they are and how long they will take. The good thing for us is they've already engaged on the subject because of the ArcelorMittal deal.
Right.
So they're familiar with the industry and the dynamics of the industry and the challenges of the industry. And we hope we will get there sooner than later.
So what would that mean, end of 2018?
We can't give any timelines just now because it's in their control.
But end of 2018,
well, for
calendar
us, that
year,
would be preferred,
financial
but
year.
It's for the European.
Any idea?
the sooner the better, but it's not in our hands. It's for the European Commission to decide. It's not for us to put pressure on them.
Okay, sorry, you may not again like this next question, but I'll ask it nonetheless. Given that there has been a considerable delay in the finalization of the joint venture terms of engagement, based on some of the objections that ThyssenKrupp's shareholders have raised in the past, unions, etc., if they were to arise again, these objections, similar or otherwise, is there any break clause in this joint venture at this point in time? So for some reason, if the deal doesn't go through, what could be the impact on... Could you benefit in any way from any kind of break clause if Thyssen calls it off? Short-term benefit, not long-term benefit.
No. I think, let me put it this way. I think directionally, I don't think any of the stakeholders had a disagreement with it. I think it was the terms which was the moot point. Even their shareholders did not disagree with the direction. I think it was more the value that they were getting out of it. Same with our stakeholders, whether it was the unions, whether it was internal stakeholders. Everyone agreed that this was the right direction, but everyone had their interests which we needed to engage with. So I don't, we like to look at the positive side of it. I think we probably weathered the more difficult part of the journey. There will be challenges ahead, but we're quite comfortable and confident that we can overcome them.
Okay, fine. I'm done with ThyssenKrupp. I'm going to talk to you about the India business. Have you taken over Bhushan Steel? Are you firmly in the driver's seat, as they call it? Because I know you were having some trouble in the initial days of getting access to the plants and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Are you finally in charge now and running it?
Very much so, very much so. I think the issues were more to do with the time when the decisions had not been taken, when the order had not been passed. The minute the order was passed and within a couple of days we paid the money and we took charge, our teams are very much in place. The local teams in the Bhushan plants have welcomed us. I think the teams are working very well together, and it's been, I think, about 45 days and things are looking good.
Okay. There still is some pending legal challenge to this, isn't there, sir?
Well, as far as Bhushan Steel is concerned, I think we are almost there. We have submitted to all the questions that were asked. We've submitted the answers and all that. I think we are pretty much there. We paid for the asset and the shares have been transferred. The boards have been changed and we are the owners as far as we are concerned. Legal issues we will continue to deal with. We respect the judgment of the courts whenever they decide.
All right, fine. Bhushan Power and Steel, it looks like Liberty House did not have much luck with its last minute bid. So is that also going to come your way? What are the chances right now?
Don't know, because we get to know more from the media. We hear what's happening. So let's wait and see. I think we are well positioned and we are ready as and when we get to know. I think we go through the appeals process. It is just now at NCLT and NCLAT. I think 12th of July is a date. We'll wait for that and we'll take it as it comes. But I think internally the teams are ready to go.
Okay. The debt that you're transferring out on account of this ThyssenKrupp joint venture, you're almost taking on a similar amount of debt on account of the Bhushan acquisition, if I'm correct, and correct me if I'm wrong here. So effectively, you're in the same place when it comes to debt at Tata Steel. What's the plan on how you're going to pare this down?
Yeah. So firstly, yes, effectively same place as you said, but with a set of assets which generate more EBITDA per ton. So that itself makes a difference. Obviously, the opportunities which came our way because of the IBC were not opportunities which were going to wait for us. So that's a call we took as a board, that we said these are opportunities which come once in a lifetime. We know how long it takes to build a steel plant. We've experienced that ourselves in a new site. And you had two sites available in our neighborhood, close to our raw material sources. In states that we have good relationships with and we operate in. And it was an opportunity which we did not want to miss. So that was the basis on which we went for it. The parent Tata Sons has also supported us on it. The board has supported us. In the short term, our debt situation may not improve, but I think our EBITDAs are improving. And the 20,000 crores of debt, which is going to move to the JV balance sheet, will certainly help us. And the EBITDA that we hope to generate out of Bhushan Steel, in addition to the fact that the India business is doing quite well otherwise, we hope will help us pare out the debt debt in the next couple of years.
But so it's going to take its own sweet time for you to pay the debt down based on the profitability that you're able to extract from the additional capacity in India. There is no immediate plan for any kind of asset divestiture that might help you actually reduce this debt?
So that goes on constantly. Even over the last few years, we've kept rationalizing and optimizing our portfolio in India and overseas.
So
that's an activity which anyway is an ongoing activity for us every year.
What's left to do, Mr. Narendra?
Well, there are a lot of companies we own, and we'll take a call depending on... So there are a lot of companies we own. We have a lot of subsidiaries. We'll take a call depending on the opportunities and the necessities.
But is there any immediate information that you can share with us? Because I know that your debt situation continues to worry the market quite a bit.
Well, it does, but if you look at our net debt to EBITDA, I think even at its peak, if we even get Bhushan and Power, I think we are around 4. And our long-term objective, as we've said over a period of time, is to bring it to below 3. So we are working towards that, and we think we have the ability to do that. So I don't have anything specific to add just now in terms of...
You know,
of,
but if I may put it this way, Mr. Narendran, at the time when you were determining the opportunities in both Bhushan and Bhushan Power and Steel, and I can understand these were a once-in-a-lifetime kind of opportunities thanks to the IBC process, you decided to go in for both of them. At that time, the trade fears that are currently, or the, you know, the winds of poor trade situations that's currently blowing through the world were not quite blowing. You're back again right now, where especially the commodities or natural resource sector is in the eye of the storm, if I may call it that way. And so you are walking a fine line. You're going to keep adding on to your debt, especially if you get Bhushan Power and Steel as well. You haven't spelled out any critical or any clear plan of being able to reduce that debt through asset divestitures. And you're looking at a slightly difficult world economy right now.
Yeah, I mean, yes and no. You know, firstly, I want to tell you that obviously we spend a lot of time thinking through these things. There's a lot of discussion on the subject, so we don't jump into things without thinking it through and building out different scenarios. So, you know, and we have been in this industry for a long time, so we understand the cycles.
Again,
so we
Mr.
take
Narendran,
our calls, right?
Forgive
so
me for interrupting you.
The first thing I want to say. The second thing is...
Forgive me for interrupting you, but I remember following the Corus transaction very, very closely and questioning even that time. You know, the acquisition of such a large entity, India's largest ever offshore deal. And I was told the same thing at that point as well, that, you know, we've been through every scenario and we think that this is going to work. And it gives us access to top-notch clients across Europe, and it allows us to get into value-added steel in ways that we'd never be able to get into in India. So I'm not suggesting that you're wrong this time either. I'm just saying that the global economy looked in a much better place 5 or 6 months ago. Things are now looking a little less certain. You are adding on debt, but you're not spelling out any plans to reduce it. How is that going to happen?
So let me address the second part of your question. I was referring to the first part. The second part of your question is on the global economy. I don't think the steel industry has seen a better time in the last 3-4 years. If you look at all the steel consuming regions, they're growing, including, and China is not doing too badly. If you see the consumption of steel in China, it has grown about 7-8% in the last 6 months. Chinese exports have dropped. Yes, Trump has taken some actions on steel, but honestly, I don't think it has hurt the steel industry as much as the noise that has been made. What has effectively happened is the steel prices in the US for hot rolled coils are in the $900 to $1,000 range. So the steel consumers in the US are paying the price for the actions that the president has taken. So if you look at Tata Steel Europe, we are selling into the US. The customers have paid us a higher price you know, than we were getting earlier. So to me, yes, there are some inconveniences, if I can call it that, but I don't think steel consumption globally has struggled. It's doing quite well. And the forecast that we made on behalf of the World Steel Association is also that we'll see a strongest year in many years. China has taken significant action on the supply side. Chinese exports have come back to what it was in 2015. It is back to about 70 million tons. Steel prices are back to where it was in 2014-15. So we are not as pessimistic about the steel industry as some others are. So we think we are in the right place at the right time. The Indian economy is doing quite well, at least as far as steel consumption is concerned. So you can never always be right, but I hope this time we are right and you're wrong.
Well, I wasn't asserting either ways in 2007-8, and I'm not asserting differently this time. I hope you're right as well. I have one final question. I know that when your earnings are announced, you will give us more details with regards to, you know, your margin performance, et cetera, and where prices are headed. But this is, you know, from a recent conversation that I had with Seshagiri Rao of JSW Steel, who expressed initial concerns about the fact that India has now turned a net importer after 3 years. And he said that because of these crosswinds on account of trade, he is, you know, fearful of the fact that we might in fact see more imports coming to this market, as a result of which it might hurt domestic manufacturers such as yourselves and Tata and JSW Steel. Are your concerns heightened on that front as well?
Well, we should always be watchful. I think all of us have suffered in 2015, and to be fair to the government, they moved in fast and took some actions, right? Even today in Europe, our concern is not so much about our exports into the US, which is going on as I described earlier. It's more the concern about is material headed for the US going to get diverted to Europe? And what do we do for that? And the European government has some plans for that. So as far as India is concerned, yes, India has turned a net importer over the last month or two. But I believe it's more because India is exporting less than importing more. The imports are still at some 400 to 500,000 tons a month. The exports, which was 600,000-700,000, maybe 800,000 a month, has dropped down to less than 400,000 tons a month. So we've turned a net importer, but I look at it a bit more positively than negatively. I think that's happening because the demand in India is growing and Indian producers are happier to sell in the domestic markets. And Indian imports has not grown to keep pace with the demand. And so to that extent, I think the situation today is very different from the situation in 2015. When we saw the imports doubling from 400,000 tons a month to maybe 800,000 tons a month. But I'm not saying we should not be watchful. I think we should be watchful and we should look at what's happening. I would always look out at how much China is exporting, because that's got the potential to be the spoiler in steel trade flows. And just now China is exporting about 5 million tons a month, which is, I think, okay.
Okay, sorry, JSW Steel stepping up its presence in the US on account of what's going on the trade front, and as a reaction to that, also because the U.S. economy is poised for substantial growth, are you interested in, since you sound so bullish on the steel cycle, are you interested in adding to U.S. exposure?
No, I think the U.S. is a good market for us to sell to from Europe, but I don't think we're looking at any investments in the U.S.
All right, we'll leave it there, sir. Thank you so much for your time, and thanks very much for all the details that you've shared with us. TV Narendran there, Managing Director and CEO of Tata Steel, talking us through not just the joint venture with ThyssenKrupp, but his outlook for the domestic steel industry as well.